My background is an activist, as a human rights activist, and I've been like very grateful for opportunities to connect with others around the world on a wide range of issues, from women's rights to LGBT rights to youth organizing, and I've been very grateful to meet friends of all diverse backgrounds. And a couple of years ago, I was on a scholarship to do my master's in the UK, and I met many people through that scholarship as well. And I also made friends from the Middle East, and a friend from Gaza. His name is Ahmed, and he's in Gaza right now. He's Palestinian. And I've been messaging him, checking on him, like, how are you doing? And, you know, telling him that, you know, there's a vigil happening tonight and I hope you're safe. And I think, like, he's just got, like, really, like, especially in the last 48 hours, like, he just got really overwhelmed with everyone telling him to be safe. And I'll just read out what he said 8 hours ago. I really can't understand it when my friends tell me to stay safe. I really wish you had to understand that there is no safe place or a way to stay safe. Everyone, everything is a target. And what Professor Vijay just said about the size of Gaza, it's a little bit smaller than Tavuni. So can you imagine 2.1 million people on Tavuni? And 1 million of them have been told to move south. So where will they be safe? How can they stay safe? I think Professor Vijay and Dr. Beam, like, they gave like a really good academic background in terms of what's happening and what has been happening since 1948, the Nakba, and when 700,000 Palestinians were dispossessed and many others were forced to flee, which is settler colonialism. I know that might be a complicated word for you, but please try and Google it, because that's exactly what's happening there right now. And I think in the last few years, there have been like sporadic conflict over there. So especially if there have been attacks by Hamas or other groups, and then there has been retaliation from Israel, and then there has been a mobilization of people protesting. And I think the most recent one was in 2020 as well, with the mosque in Sheikh Jarrah and all of that. And so I've always, as a human rights activist, I've always been following, you know, what people are doing and how people are mobilizing. And what really affected me with this conflict was that I felt like awful things were happening and our leaders were saying that we stand with Israel. And then people around me were not doing anything. They were not saying anything. Because if you live in Fiji, like, you have friends in the church who follow the biblical Israel, and maybe some of them, just one of your relatives just returned from the trip that was made to Tel Aviv in Israel, and maybe many others of you are not really familiar with the situation, but then you see it on the news. And what has been happening in the last few days has been genocide. We cannot call it a war. We cannot call it a conflict. It is genocide. When you tell people to flee, to move to the south of the country, south of this piece of land, when you cut off their internet, when you cut off their electricity, when you cut off access to their to safe water, when you cut off access to like humanitarian aid, when you use language in the media calling them cockroaches, calling them vermin, and when world leaders say that they need to be wiped out, Israel has a right to defend itself, it is genocide. And I want you to all to think, like, 20 years from now, like, we are in a unique moment of history where a genocide is happening in front of us. We might not have had the benefit of other genocides that have took place because we obviously didn't have the internet, but now we just need to turn on the internet. Go on Facebook, go on X, go on Instagram, and we see it happening in front of us. And I think 10, 20 years from now, like, people will be asking, like, oh my God, these horrible things happened. What were other people doing? Were you afraid to speak out because you were afraid that you're going to lose your job? Were you afraid to speak out because your family members are in that pro-Israel church or whatever? Were you afraid to speak out because you didn't want to be unpopular? Speaking up for oppressed people is never like a popular thing to do. And I hope that like all of us can reflect on that. And because like if we don't speak up, then, you know, like we're just a small country in Fiji, but then, you know, like I think we can build a movement of people, you know, who can speak out against these atrocities that are currently happening. And especially the last 24 hours, that hospital, 500 people dead, including children. How can we let that happen? I just want to end with a quote from Celine Siman. She's an activist, she's an author. Advocating against oppression is not the most popular thing to do. It puts you and your career at risk. It renders you a target. So when you decide to remain silent while witnessing your peers resisting occupation, you feed the oppression. Your silence makes the courageous a target. Your silence is cowardice. When we reflect on history at any of the multitudes of genocides that have happened and wonder, how did people let these atrocities happen? We often reason that they must not have known. Well, now the whole world knows. War is terror and must end now. End quote. So I hope like we've heard from some speakers today, and I think we're going to still be hearing from other people. If you can take that knowledge and please speak out if it's safe for you to do so, and please learn from others, and please, you know, like especially consuming media as well, especially mainstream media like BBC, CNN, and we've sort of seen how they have sort of used disinformation about beheaded babies, which was not true. So please also be mindful of that. But then again, also just use your voice, because I think that's the only thing, that's the most powerful thing that we can have. Thank you.